But we are going to continue our walk through Hebrews here. Previously, we just started off in Hebrews chapter 1, looking at verses 1, 2, and the first half of verse 3. And so we're picking off in the second half of verse 3 and moving on to the end of chapter 1 there. But as I was breaking down the verses and, just kind of looking and reading through it, I began to find and ask myself, why did I choose the book of Hebrews? Because the book is very much so the meat of Scripture, right? It's not very much so, as we would say, milk, where it's easy to digest, but it is very much so the meat that is very, very true, but sometimes very hard to comprehend with much truth to it. And so I ask that you guys hang on tight with me as we venture through Scripture today. And so let's go to God together and ask that He be with us as we go through His Word. Let's pray together. God, we pray and we ask that You guide us today as we look through Your Word, specifically in Hebrews, Lord. May You go before me, and may You open up the hearts and the minds of the congregation here today. Let us see what Your Word has to say to us and what truth it will reveal to us, Lord. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Greatness is a very abstract concept, right? We can say many things are great. We can say that one thing is greater than the other, right? But if we leave the verb of great alone with something that we're trying to describe, then it might be a little confusing, right? If you simply come up to me and you say that you believe that you have found the greatest pho restaurant out there, I can, come to believe you. I can try to listen to what you're trying to say, but I might not fully understand just how great that pho restaurant is, right? If you come to me and you say, hey, I believe I found the greatest Korean barbecue restaurant, or I believe that this athlete is the greatest, right? I can, I can say, okay, sure, they're the greatest, but I don't understand how much their greatness is or how great they actually are, right? And the way that we help ourselves to interpret that is by comparison, right? Okay, if you come up to me and you say, okay, I have found the greatest pho restaurant that is better than Pho 79, Pho Dewey, Saigon Basil, right? Then I can say to myself, okay, well, Saigon Basil's broth is like this, their noodles are like that, Pho Dewey has, good tendon or good brisket, whatever it might be. If that pho restaurant is better than, all these that we have eaten, then I can say, okay, that means their brisket is better, their noodles are better, their broth is better, right? Based on comparison, I know just how great that pho restaurant would be, right? And those of you guys who follow sports, you guys know how much we love to compare athletes, right? We always say that this person is better than that person because we love to compare statistics and all these things, right? Comparison helps us to understand something's greatness, right? And in the text that we're about to follow, we're about to find that Jesus is greater than the angels. The author of Hebrews comes up to us and says, previously, right, from verses 1, 2, and 3, I have generally spoken about the greatness of Jesus, right? I have said he is the heir to all things. He has created all things, right? But to help us understand just how great he is, let me compare him to the angels, right? Let me say and show that, hey, the angels are like this, but Jesus, he is more, he is superior, he is greater. Now, beyond just the sake of comparison, the author, if we remember, was writing this epistle with a reason, right? He is writing to the Jews, right? Both the believing and the unbelieving Jews at that time. And what he's trying to say here is that you Jews who are still holding on to the old covenant, right? The old ways, the old Ten Commandments, the old laws, the old rituals, right? The old sacrificial law. If you still hold on to those things, then there is something greater than that, right? It's superior in every way. To those Jews previously who had or who still hold on to the old covenant, what they have found themselves doing is that they ended up muddying the water a little bit here. Because our understanding is that we believe only in God, right? But to those previous Jews, they ended up thinking and saying, okay, well, who brought God's word to us, right? And they found and they said, okay, well, the angels did. The angels have brought God's word. They were messengers from God. So that must mean that they are then the mediators for us and God, right? So then they elevate the angels into that role of mediator. And so what that ends up doing for them is that they say, if they mediate for us between us and God, then that must mean that we must then worship them as we worship God as well. Now, we all know that that is not true. And so the author of Hebrew writes this to say, no, let's pause on that for a second here and let's really understand who the angels are, but even more importantly, that we have an actual mediator who is Jesus Christ for us. And what he's trying to do is move the Jews from the old covenant, right, into understanding the new covenant, right? That there is a mediator found in this new covenant, that being Jesus Christ. And so he does this by showcasing that Jesus is superior to the angels, that he is greater and better than them. And he does this in three different ways, telling us that Jesus is greater than the angels because, one, that he is the Son, two, because he is the one worshipped, and three, because he is God. And so if you guys would like to turn with me in your Bibles, once again, to Hebrews chapter 3, we're going to once again start off in the second half of verse 3, and we're going to read to verse 5, and this is where we find how Jesus is greater as the Son. So starting from the second half of verse 3, it reads for us here, "When he had made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much better than the angels as he has inherited a more excellent name than they. For to which of the angels did he ever say, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you,' and again, 'I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me'?" And so we directly, once again, pick up from the second half of verse 3 here, where the author reminds us of what Christ has done for us, right? As we all should know, Christ himself has died on the cross for us, right? Taking away our sins, making us pure, and justifying us before the Father, allowing us to be seen as clean. And so we ask then, how is he able to do this? What grants him the authority to do such a marvelous and spectacular thing for us? And it explains here, because he sits at the right hand of the Father, or as it says, next to the Majesty on high. His high place in heaven, his right hand side next to the Father, allows him to be that perfect mediator for us. And so this moves the author into bringing up the first comparison here, where it's Jesus compared to the angels. And the reason that he says this, right, the reason why Jesus is greater than the angels is because of his name, which is, as we see, is the Son, right? And when we think about name, right, that usually only sticks to us as what we call someone, right? You call me Nathan, that makes me my name. If you meet someone named Bob, then he is just Bob. You meet Joe, his name is just Joe, right? And so if we read this just at face value, then we would say, okay, so Jesus is greater just because his name is Jesus. Well, yes, but also no, because we also understand that this just not only pertains to what he's called, right, but also to his title. And we see that his title that's been said here, as well as through the rest of the text here, is the Son. And not just the Son, but the Son of God. And so we have the title that is then attached to the name which he is called by. It's similar to how if you meet a doctor, you don't just call them, you know, Bob, but you call them Dr. Bob, which is also their role and their responsibility and their authority, which is attached to their name, right? And so similarly to this, where we have Jesus, the Son of God, we have Jesus as his name, but his title, the Son of God, which holds his authority and his power. The author of Hebrews quotes the Old Testament here from Psalm and 2 Samuel, telling us the importance of that title as the Son of God, right? The two of them being saying that, "You are my son, today I have begotten you, and I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me," right? He's stating that this is what God the Father has called God the Son, right? This is his title, and this is his name, right? And so we might wonder, we might say, okay, that's nice, and that's great, but how does that make him greater than the angels? How does that put him above other beings, right? If he's just the Son, then like, woohoo, right? Where does that take us? But it's in understanding the relationship between the Son and the Father that displays his greatness. This isn't in any way meant to demean the angels or lessen their role, but rather it's to extend and showcase the greatness of Jesus. And once again, the title of son that Jesus bears here is less of a family explanation, right? Because as we read it, sometimes we just simply think of like Jesus as dad and or God as dad and Jesus as the son of God the Father. And that's it, right? Where it's just a familial relationship. But it is much more beyond that, because those descriptors there where it's God the Father and God the Son, as we know, are not, in a sense, what they actually just are, right? But rather they are meant and put in there in Scripture and described to us so that we in our finite human minds can understand their role. Okay, once again, it's described and said that it is God the Father and God the Son, not just because that's just who they are, but that helps us understand their role, because we cannot comprehend God fully as who he is. And so it's God the Father, so we can say, oh, okay, he is the Father, meaning that he reigns over people, he rules, and he is the one that has the will to send people. And we can say that Jesus is the Son because he is submissive to the Father and his will. And so the greatness is then once again found in the relationship between the Father and the Son, right? Where the angels have never been called the Son, meaning that they do not have the same relationship with God the Father as Jesus does, right? There is an intimate, very interpersonal relationship that is between Jesus and God the Father, right? Similarly to how all of us have interpersonal and very intimate relationships with our parents, right? We can hang out with our friends and we can hang out with their parents, but we may never, ever fully understand what our friend's relationship is like with their parents, right? We know what ours is like with our parents. It's extremely intimate, very personal, right? We know each other, we love each other, we care for each other, but we only know what that relationship is like. And so thus, it's the same for Jesus and the Father. Their relationship shows and expands on the greatness of Jesus, where he understands what to do, how to submit to God the Father, what the will is, what his role is altogether. And it's all encompassed in understanding the Trinity, right? We have to include this doctrine in here, because if we take it out, then we kind of end up with two gods here and we're confused, right? But we have to include this doctrine of the Trinity, where we understand where we have one God, but that God is in three persons, where we have God the Son, God the Father, and God the Holy Spirit, where all three reside together, where all three are in agreement together and complete understanding. The angels are a majestic creation who are blessed to do the will of God and reside with him in heaven, yet they pale in comparison to the Son, who has an eternal relationship with the Father. And so what greatness does this relationship bring forth? Okay, we see that he's greater because the title of the Son. We see that it's great because he has a relationship with the Father. Well, what does that bring for us, right? What greatness is found in that? And the greatness is found in him being able to be the mediator for us, right? Just as we said, contextually, like the audience here, the letter that this is written to is to the Jews, right? Who came to believe that because the angels are messengers of God, that they are then mediators for us to God. But as we know, that's not the truth, because they don't have that relationship with the Father as Jesus does. And so we place Jesus then as mediator for us, and he is perfect for that role. Never did the angels have the opportunity to save us in the way that Jesus did. Instead, we know that Jesus was the perfect sacrifice, making him the perfect mediator for us. We are allowed to go to God because of what Jesus has done for us, right? And it was described already back in verse 3, where it said that he perfectly absolved us of our sins. He purified us. Right? The greatness is found in his life, in his death, in his resurrection, right? Allowing us to be with God, to be invited into the family of God. The greatness is in that he would be willing to die for the undeserving so that the undeserving would be invited into the family of God. His title is beyond what any of us can know and understand. Now, secondly, in verse 6 here, the second point being that Jesus is greater than the angels because he is the one worshipped. If you guys want to read with me here, it's very quick. Verse 6 says, And when he again brings the firstborn into the world, he says, and let all the angels of God worship him. And while this verse is, you know, extremely short, just a few sentences here, you may wonder, is this really worth breaking down? It seems straightforward, very cut and concise, right? But the truth must be shown to us from Scripture here that Jesus is greater, once again, because he is the Son and also because he is the one worshipped, right? While the angels are the messengers of God, they are not the mediators for us, so we do not have a response of worship to them as we do to the Son, as we do to God. The angels simply brought the word of God to the people and nothing more, right? So they did not die for our sins. They did not justify us. They did not purify us of our sins. They will not be coming back again as in the same manner of Jesus. They did not make us righteous. So they do not hold a responsibility to be worshipped as Jesus is. And the argument being made here by the author is that Jesus is greater than the angels because he is the one who is worshipped, right? And there is a logical sort of steps here that we take when we read this, right? If we read it at face value, once again, it says, and let the angels of God worship him, right? And so we understand that the angels themselves are worshiping something. And so the character in there, that being him, would be Jesus himself. And so if the angels are worshiping Jesus, then it only makes sense that we kind of go around the angels and we don't worship the being that is worshiping another being, but we go straight to the fact that we worship the one who is being worshiped by the angels themselves, right? And so if the angels are worshiping Jesus, then that also means that he is greater than them, right? Because no being worships something lower than them. No being worships something lesser than them. The angels only worship that which is greater than them. Now, beyond just the logic of this verse, there is also reason for the angels to worship Jesus as well. And that is found in the word firstborn there. Now, when we hear firstborn, we usually think of it meaning it in a sense of time, right? And so when we say firstborn, we just simply say, okay, if someone is named as the firstborn, that just means that they were literally born first, right? In the timeline, in chronologically, that just points them at point A versus the rest, right? And while it is true that Jesus was the firstborn, that he was at the beginning, this word firstborn here speaks less of a place in time and more towards position and stature. And so on the one hand, you know, firstborn literally means, like I said, the first one to be born. But if we think back, perhaps even now, and specifically to the Old Testament, right? When we say firstborn, if you're the firstborn child, then you hold certain responsibilities, but you also have certain rights, right? You know, back in the Old Testament, if you were the firstborn son, that means you had to do certain things. But that also meant that if your parents passed away, you inherited everything, right? Similarly, now to the firstborn children in here, you have certain things that you must do, right? But you also hold certain rights in the home, right? Sometimes you end up being mom and dad number two, right? But that also means that you also hold a right to the inheritance or certain things that your mom and dad give you, right? And so positionally, that places you higher than the rest of your siblings. And so relating it back to Jesus as the firstborn, that means then that if he is the firstborn, not just time-wise, but positionally and stature-wise, then that means that he is above the angels as well. He has certain rights, he has certain things that belong to him that the angels do not have. If we reference back to verse 2 in it saying, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, right? And as we know, the firstborn inherits everything. That shows to us that, okay, he is the firstborn, he will inherit all things. Verse 2 says that he will be the inherited. Then that shows us, okay, he is truly the firstborn. not just in time, but in position and stature as well. And so bringing all of this together to its original context here, right? Once again, remembering that this is written to the Jews, where they said and they saw it as good to worship the angels, or we know that that is not the right thing, where instead, right, because if we think about this, where we think about we only worship the greatest thing, right? And I said this previously as well. We don't go from, you know, if we are at the lowest and the least, we don't try to worship the thing that is in second place, right? That doesn't make any sense. We don't reward that which is in second place. We only reward that which is in first place. We only praise that which is the highest. We only worship that which is in the utmost, the greatest thing. That is not the angels. That is Christ alone, seen as greater than the angels because he holds the title of son and because he is the one being worshipped by the angels. It once again does not make any sense for us to go, let me go and worship the one who is worshiping something else, right? Let me go give praise to something that still is giving praise to something even greater. Rather than do that, let us go straight to the one who is deserving and worthy of the praise himself, that being Jesus. And even in that itself, there are dangers to the worship of something outside of God, right? The Jews themselves, if they saw fit to worship the angels, then there is a error in their theology and in their thinking, in their translation, in their interpretation of Scripture, right? Because we know that we don't worship anything else besides God. And if we worship the angels, then we begin to equate them as God. But they are not, and as we see here, Jesus is greater than them, so we worship Jesus alone. We do not worship the angels. The author of Hebrews here is saying to his Jewish audience, do not worship the angels, instead worship the one whom they worship, that being Christ Jesus, right? And in doing so, he's once again saying, move from this old covenant into the new covenant, right? Don't be so fixated on the old ways and the old things where we must do X, Y, and Z, and where you believe that the angels are the mediators when they're not. Instead, move to this new covenant where we actually find the perfect sacrifice, where we find the perfect mediator, where we find the mediator who is greater than the angels, which is Jesus. He alone is worthy of being worshipped. He alone has brought to us a new covenant of faith and repentance. And so up to this point, we have seen that Jesus is greater than the angels because he is granted the title of son and because he is the one worshipped, right? And all of these two things have been pointing to verses 17 to 14 here, which is showing us that Jesus is greater because he is God. And if you guys will read with me, it's a little lengthy, but bear with me as we read together here. Starting in verse 7, and of the angels he says, who makes his angels winds and his ministers a flame of fire? But of the Son he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever, and the righteous scepter is the scepter of his kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness above your companions. And you, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. And they all will become old like a garment, and like a mantle you will roll them up. Like a garment they will also be changed, but you are the same, and your years will not come to an end. But to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to render service for the sake of those who will inherit salvation? So once again, the grand point here being made is that Jesus is greater as God, right? And we understand that in the first point, when we spoke about Jesus being greater as the Son, there is an understanding that he is God the Son, right? Because once again, bringing into it the Trinity, all three, you know, are equal in power, but different in role. They are all God, so that would make Jesus God. And then the second point being that he is greater because he's the one worshipped. Well, he is worshipped because he is God. And so it all culminates together in this point here that Jesus is greater because he is simply God. Verse 7 brings forth the statement describing the angels in relation to Jesus, where he is the one who aids them, who has created them, right? He is not just worshipped by the angels, but he is also created by him, and they are ruled by him, right? It reads, together it says, who makes his angels winds and his ministers a flame of fire. So who grants the angels the winds under their wings? Who grants them the ministering fire that they have? That would be Christ the Son himself. And in verse 8, it still holds on to, once again, the title as Jesus, as the Son, right? But it grants us a different perspective into him being God. It displays what kind of God he truly is. It describes his nature. It describes his attributes. At the beginning, it says, O God, or your throne, O God, is forever and ever. And as we have seen previously and as we see now, we have seen a lot of God says this to God and God has said this to him. And we really have to make sure that we figure out which part of the Trinity it is being spoken about, right? If we confuse it, then it looks like Jesus is speaking to the Son, or God is speaking to simply himself, right? And so here it is speaking about the Father speaking to the Son, saying that your throne, Jesus, is forever and ever, right? And he's describing and he's displaying and speaking the title and saying, okay, Jesus as God the Son, your throne is forever and ever. Now, this isn't God the Father relinquishing his title, right, where he's saying, I am passing it down to you, nor is it him promoting Jesus to being God, right? It's simply God the Father recognizing Jesus as God, right? And so if God the Father is recognizing Jesus as God, then that should simply put in our minds that Jesus is God. Not only that, but it is described that his throne will be forever and ever. And so as we know, the term forever and ever meaning that his throne is unending, right? Not only that it is unending, but it also means that it was forever existing since the beginning, right? So it wasn't at any point that Jesus became God, right? It wasn't that when he resurrected, suddenly he became a God, but it is that ever since the beginning of time, he has forever existed as God. Onwards, the verses describe what kind of God he is, right? Where he rules with a scepter of righteousness, or some other translations say a scepter of justice, right? Where he loves righteousness and he hates wickedness or lawlessness. And this describes not only how he rules, but it describes himself as well, where Jesus is complete and he is whole in his righteousness. And because he is whole in his righteousness and whole in his goodness, he hates evil, he hates wickedness, he hates lawlessness. And so if he's fully good and he hates all evil, that means he rules with complete justice, right? He deals with things in whole just. That which is evil, he will, you know, punish, and that which is good, he will reward. And so we begin to take a peek quickly into the attributes of God here, right? Where firstly, we see that Jesus as God, simply as, you know, the rest of the Trinity is, Jesus is righteous, and Jesus is just. And the ending of this Old Testament reference quote here is, may seem a little odd here, but helps us to understand once again his position, right? Because he is God, because his throne is forever and ever, because he is fully just, because he is fully righteous, because he hates evil, because he punishes the wicked, because he loves that which is good, he has been anointed above his companions, right? It says, therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness above your companions. And once again, we have to make sure we place correctly the Trinity in this text here, right? Where it says, therefore God the Son, right? Your God the Father has anointed you. So God the Father has anointed God the Son above the others, right? And the word is companions there. And so companions could mean several different things, right? But in this text, contextually, what it's been saying this whole time is that he is oil, or he has been exalted above the angels themselves. He has been anointed above the angels. His title, his nature, and his deity bring him above and make him greater and superior above every being. The author of Hebrews then uses another verse from the book of Psalms to describe Jesus' deity, and as we saw previously, where it describes the attributes of Jesus in being just and being righteous, we then see two more for us here in these verses. Namely, we will see how God is eternal, and we will see how he is unchanging, right? And the large terms used here are often that he has, or his eternality, making him eternal, and his immutability, or that he is unchanging. And so from the start of verse 10 there, it says, "You, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth." And so once again, we in the previous verse, it says that his throne is forever and ever. It's unending. Okay, so it has no end. And it says that you, Lord, in the beginning, literally meaning ever since the beginning, meaning that there was, whatever the starting point was, Jesus was there as well. And what was he there doing? He was laying the foundations of the earth, right? Now, if we kind of take ourselves all the way back to Genesis 1, we understand that the earth was created by God and that everything else from light to the universe was created by him. And oftentimes when we read Genesis 1, we kind of just seem to believe and plug in God the Father or just God simply there. But if we reference over to John chapter 1, where it says that through the Son, everything was created and nothing outside of him was created, and we bring in Genesis 1, and we bring in John chapter 1, and we bring it here in this verse, and that, to our understanding, is that at the beginning, not only was God the Father there, not only was the Spirit there above the waters, but also Christ was there too, and he was the means of creation. Through him, everything was created, and outside of him, nothing else was created, and nothing outside of him exists. Not only was the earth created by him, but also the heavens as well. And the heavens are the works of your hands. The heavens and the earth are his work. Nothing outside of that is created. And so we then kind of find ourselves at an interesting point here where it says, okay, so at the beginning he created and laid out the foundations of the earth and he also created the heavens. And then we meet this point where it says yet or but, right? Yet they will perish, yet they will go away like old garments, but you will remain, right? And for one, this is to show and display just how unchanging and eternal God is, right? Because we understand that the things of this world will go away eventually. That no matter how great the mountains may seem, no matter how unchanging they go, no matter what day we go, right, out on the street and we start driving west and we say the mountains are there and they're forever there and we know we're going west because the mountains are in that direction, right? They are still changing. Yet our God, yet Jesus himself is unchanging. And this is plugged in here because we understand that when Jesus comes back in his second coming, that he plans to remove and demolish everything from the old creation to the old earth to the old heaven and grant us a new earth and a new heaven. Yet God himself is eternal and unchanging. And so if we take these attributes that we have seen here, right, where he is just and he is fully righteous and he is unchanging and he is eternal, it is displaying for us not just his attributes, but it is describing and showing if he holds these and he holds these in completion, then he must be and is God. Finally, in the last quote from the Old Testament from Psalms here that we find in verse 13 where it says, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." The author interestingly introduces to us sort of in a negative term, right? It says, "But to which of the angels has he ever said?" And it's we can kind of take it sarcastically too because that's the tone that's taken there. We might ask, why not just say that this is what he says about his son, right? Why say, but has he ever said this about the angels, right? Has he ever described them in this way? Has he ever told them about this? Why not just say, well, he says this about the Son, right? And it's not just for the sake of being sarcastic where he says, well, do you know, has he ever said this about the angels? But rather he's trying to make us actually think for ourselves to say, has he said this about the angels, right? And the fact is, he has only said this to Jesus the Son, right? The Father has only spoken this to the Son to say, You will sit at my right hand, and I will make your enemies a footstool. Right? Never has he said to any of the angels, you may sit at my right hand, I will make your enemies your footstool. To his son, this has only been said and claimed for him. It is to make it clear that this is something exclusively said to the Son, that the seat at the right hand of God the Father is reserved and made only for Jesus. And so then we then begin to, you know, wonder and question and ask, if everything before this from verses 3b to verse 13 says, you know, Jesus is greater than the angels in this way, they are better than him in this way, oh, well, what of the angels then? What is their purpose? What role do they play? Why even include them in this comparison if Jesus is much greater than them? Why do they exist, right? And so verse 14 helps us there, and it says, are they not all ministering spirits sent out to render service for the sake of those who inherit salvation, right? Their purpose and their place and their task is to serve those who inherit salvation. And so we ask ourselves, who would that be, right? And so those would be people who come to faith in Jesus Christ, who would commit themselves and say, I have come to believe, I repent of my sins. Lord, you are my Savior, right? And that long description simply describes us, right? The angels have been purposed not only to serve God, but also to serve us. And what a blessing that is that they have been tasked to minister, to serve, and to help us. And once again, looping this all back together into the audience that this was written to, which was the Jews, where the Jews sought to worship the angels because they believed that Jesus was an angel, or perhaps that the angels were God themselves. We see through these 3 points that Jesus is greater than them, and so he is the only one to be worshipped because he is God, right? Because he is included in all the attributes of God. He is the Son of God. He is a part of the Trinity making him God. He is worshipped as God, and he has forever and ever existed since the beginning. He is the created, or he is the creator. He created everything through him. Everything is created. Nothing outside of him is created. And so these truths that we have gone through here about Jesus being superior to the angels may seem a little long-winded, right? Why does the author of Hebrews go through such length to go back to the Old Testament, grab a quote, put it here, have us try to understand it? Why not just say simply, hey, Jesus is greater than the angels, awesome, cool, let's move on, right? And a little bit of a spoiler here to what we're going to dive into next, which is found in verse 2, it's so that we truly know and understand what we believe, right? It's so that we can grab it and understand that not only is Jesus just greater than the angels, so that we can find down to the finite point and say, well, why is he greater than the angels, right? I always tell the youth that the favorite question that's always said over in Sunday school by the children over there is always, why? You know, if you describe to them, well, God loves us. Why? Well, because he died for us. Why? Well, because he wants us to join him in the family of heaven. Why? And it goes on and on and on, right? It's so that we might be able to answer the question, not for people, but for ourselves, right? Why is Jesus so great? Well, in this instance, we can say that he's greater than the angels in that comparison. Well, why is he greater than the angels? Well, because he is the Son. He has this greater name and title than them. Because he is the one worthy of worship, and because he is God. I know that sometimes we kind of end up with selective hearing when we come to church on Sunday, because we come every Sunday and we kind of hear what we have only heard previously, and everything else just kind of goes out the other ear, right? But take these truths and hold on to them, because we have to, and I say this, I feel like I say this every single time I'm up here, but we have to know what we know so that we know. Otherwise, if we only know once and then something comes and hits us and we collapse and we don't ask our question, we don't ask ourselves why, then if we don't know the reason, we don't know the thing that holds us down, we don't have a foundation, then we simply collapse, right? And so hold on to these truths. Know so that you know, so that you know that Jesus is superior to the angels and he's greater than all things. Let's pray together. God, God, we come before you and we pray and we ask that you would continue to move our hearts into our minds into understanding you, into knowing you so that we might build a foundation that is strong and strengthened in you and in your word. May you continually remind us that Jesus, you are greater than all things, you are greater than the angels, because of your name, your title, because we worship you, and because you are God. May you continue to remind us of that each and every day, and may we never forget that. May it be written on our hearts and on our minds, Lord. Continue to watch over us as we go out into the world, as we go vacation, as we go back to work, as we go out and do daily tasks, Lord. Protect us and watch over us, and may you continue to be with us. And if you have not returned yet, we pray and we ask that you bring us to church here next week safely. We love you and we thank you. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.